According to the 16th century Florentine art historian Giorgio Vasari, it was Giotto who finally turned painting away from the primitive influence of Byzantium and set it moving on a new course. It's to Vasari that Giotto owes his reputation as the father of Western painting. But I don't think it makes sense to talk about any artist in those terms. There are no absolute beginnings. I also think it's important to recognize that the Byzantine East played a much more formative role in the development of Renaissance art than Vasari was prepared to concede. The Church of Saint Panteleimon is in the mountains overlooking the city of Skopje in Macedonia, only a few miles from the border with war-torn Kosovo. If Vasari had seen the frescoes here, he would have been forced to rewrite his account of the origins of the Renaissance. We don't know exactly who painted these frescoes and others like them in the Balkans. Tests on the pigments have revealed extensive use of local plants and goat's milk. But the painters responsible for these works almost certainly learned their craft in Constantinople. These frescoes are proof that there was more to Byzantine art than the formality and otherworldliness of its mosaic and icon tradition. Contrary to what Vasari believed, Byzantine art wasn't static. It did have the capacity to change into something more obviously human and realistic. So anticipating the Franciscan emphasis on Christ as a man of flesh and blood. The deposition is as emotional as any scene in the Arena Chapel. The figures are bent double in anguish, like trees in a storm. The Lamentation is one of the most moving depictions of Mary mourning the dead Jesus that I've ever seen. She cradles him between her legs as if he's being born. A fusion of life and death in a single image. Figures of individual saints depicted in other parts of the church, you can actually see the direct continuity between Byzantine painting and the art of ancient Greece and Rome. This is not so much a case of the rediscovery of antiquity as of the survival in Byzantine art of methods taught in the painters' workshops of the classical world. The face of St. Valentine has all the immediacy of a Roman tomb portrait. St. John the Baptist has a physical, electric presence. These frescoes were painted in the 1160s, which means that they predate Giotto's Arena Chapel by a century and a half. It's unlikely that Giotto or Nicola or Giovanni Pisano or any of the other pioneering figures of Italian Renaissance art would have seen these actual paintings. But there was a constant traffic of people and ideas between the East and the West. The Franciscans were particularly active throughout Byzantium, and travelling friars would have seen a whole range of Byzantine art and artefacts. Vasari and many Renaissance scholars since have caricatured Byzantine art as a tradition frozen in its own conventions. It's as if the dynamism of the West must be seen to triumph over the stasis of the East. But I prefer to think of the Renaissance not as the outcome of a battle for supremacy between different styles of representation, but as a tapestry made up of many threads. Indeed, at the heart of Florence, the quintessential Renaissance city, according to Vasari, there's an example of how integral a presence the Byzantine was at the dawn of the Renaissance. Baptistry was begun in 1225 and finished a century later. Several generations of artists from both East and West collaborated on these mosaics, which are often relegated to a footnote in most accounts of Western art. But for me, the baptistry is on a par with the Sistine Chapel ceiling. The figure of Christ sits in serene majesty. He's the still point around which turn scenes from universal history and the Last Judgment. There's an energy to these other parts of the ceiling which goes beyond what's seen as the traditional forte of mosaic. The formal, almost abstract qualities of these mosaics are galvanized by a powerful sense of movement and rhythm. Hell is terrifying, full of multi-hued monsters whose skins, because of the bright reflective surface of the mosaic, have a reptilian sheen. I imagine the 14th century Florentine poet Dante standing beneath this wriggling vortex and finding inspiration for his Inferno. There's a huge divide between our world and the vision of the universe on this ceiling. But something of its aura, its cosmic glow, can be found in the spiritual intensity of later, more modern art. Think of the infinity which shines in Turner's Venetian sunsets, or of the yearning for the absolute in Van Gogh's explosive suns and radiant yellow landscapes.
Hey.